Hey, it's Phil. Happy holidays, Merry Christmas, Happy Hanukkah, all of that good stuff. I was just hoping you could do me a favor. The podcast has been nominated for a Disney Podcast Award, and the way the podcast award is awarded is based on iTunes ratings and reviews. So if you haven't yet rated the show on iTunes, please do me a favor. Pause right here. Well, not right here. I'll tell you how to do it. Pause in a second. Just head over to eartothertravel.com/iTunes. There you will find a step-by-step guide on how to rate and review the show on iTunes. So again, eartothertravel.com/iTunes to rate and review the show. Okay, now pause. Did you pause? Seriously, pause it and go rate and review it. And an honest rating and review. You don't need to give me 5 stars or tell me I'm the best. I just want an honest rating and review. Okay, now pause. All right, I'm back. Thank you so much for rating and reviewing the show. I sincerely hope you're enjoying it and you continue to enjoy it. Thank you so much again. Happy holidays. And here we go with the show.
From the Ear to There Travel Studio, this is the Ear to There Disney Podcast.
The Ear to There Podcast, it's time to start the show. Be sure to hold on tight, here we go. Exploring all the different Disney destinations. Ear to There, it's time to start the fun.
Hello everybody and welcome to the Ear to There Disney Podcast, Walt Disney World Word of the Week. I'm your host, Phil Gramlich. I am also the owner and the operator of Ear to There Travel, which is a Disney-specialized travel agency. So I, along with all of the other agents here at Ear to There Travel, we want to help you have the exact same vacation experience that we would have with our families. Whether you're in Walt Disney World, in Disneyland, on a Disney cruise line, or anywhere else, really, that your vacation may take you. And the reason I started this agency was I didn't want it to be a nameless, faceless travel agency. I have handpicked every single agent that works here at Ear to Their Travel. I interviewed them. I helped train everyone here. And I assure everyone on the team has the exact same passion for Disney that I do. So whether you want me to plan your trip or one of the other agents on the team, I say agents, but we like to call them vacationers. So I guess I'm the head vacationer, the main, I don't know. But no matter which member of the Ear to There Travel team that you pick to help with your trip, it is my promise to you that they will take the exact same care of your vacation that they would when taking care of and planning their own vacation. As always, get your free quote over at eartothertravel.com. All right, on to the show. This week's Walt Disney World Word of the Week is brought to you by the letter C. C for carousel. All right, now I know what you're thinking, right? I already did a C for carousel. A while back, I had a Word of the Week episode all about the carousels in Walt Disney World and Disneyland. That's not what this one is about. See, that carousel episode, the word was spelled with 2 R's. C-A-R-R. O-U-S-E-L. This one is spelled with 1 R. So C-A-R-O-U-S-E-L. I can spell. And I didn't even have to edit that part. Okay. This week is all about Walt Disney's Carousel of Progress. And it truly is Walt Disney's Carousel of Progress. I mean, I think if you went and got a black light like they do on those creepy hotel expose shows, and you went over the entire attraction looking for Walt Disney's fingerprints, I bet you would still find them. Hopefully your mind didn't go somewhere else when I started talking about that. But I'll bet his fingerprints are still all over the attraction. This was said to be his favorite attraction. And it's also been said that he never wanted this one to cease operation out in Disneyland. Now, of course, it did stop out there on the West Coast, but we did get it here on the East Coast, but I'll get to that in a couple of minutes. So in the 1960s, Walt had ideas for 2 additions that would run parallel to Main Street USA in Disneyland. One was International Street. The second one was Edison Square. And these were two streets that were going to kind of run across Main Street USA. You could get to them by walking down Main Street, making a left toward, let's say, International Street, or making a right toward Edison Square. Now, those two lands sadly never came to be. But as Disney has always said, good ideas never die. Or as I guess that's what we say in the Disney community. So International Street went on to inspire World Showcase in Epcot. And Edison Square eventually went on to inspire Liberty Square and the Hall of Presidents, of course, over in Magic Kingdom. But one of the show ideas that Walt Disney had, and this was his idea for Edison Square, was to have a stage show that would show the history of electricity or the progress of electricity over the years. So that was kind of put on a back burner when Edison Square wasn't created. But then when in 1964-65 New York World's Fair came around, Walt Disney pitched the electricity through the years idea to GE, who would personally come to Walt looking for an idea for their pavilion. And guess what? GE loved it. GE, of course, being General Electric. So they loved the idea, and Walt and his Imagineers got cracking on what would then be known as Progress Land. Now, this Progress Land attraction was eventually built in New York, and in the attraction, guests sit in their seats while the outer ring of theaters moves around the fixed sets on the stages. Now, there were six theaters to start, just like there are today. And you may be saying to yourself, wait, there's only four scenes in Carousel of Progress. And while that's true, there are actually six theaters. Remember, there's the opening scene, the opening theater, and then there's a closing scene, the closing theater, each which do not have a stage or an act or scene on the stage, if that makes sense. I think it does. You have two empty theaters without stages, four theaters with stages and scenes. Okay. Originally, the theater moved in a clockwise position. It now, of course, moves counterclockwise. And the show does, in fact, follow a typical American family through four acts of their lives, and it follows the history or the progression of electricity through the first act was the 1900s, the second act, the 1920s, the third act, the 1940s, and the fourth act, of course, is the 21st century. So these days, there's a pretty big jump at the end between the second to last and the last scene. But in the 1960s, it made a lot more sense, as there were people actually sitting in those chairs in the theaters that experienced all four eras of electricity. Just an aside, really, it's still a phenomenal attraction. I mean, listen, I have an affinity for Walt Disney and all things classic Disney. But just a couple of years ago, we took my kids for the first time. I think they were 4 and 6. I had twin 4-year-olds and a 6-year-old. And we held off on taking them when they were younger than that because we were like, well, they're not going to get it. They're not going to understand. They're not going to care. When they saw it at 4 and 6, they absolutely fell in love with it. And we go every single time we're at Magic Kingdom now, we go and see the show. They absolutely love it. They sing this song. They sing it all day after we listen. It's so much fun. So I really think it really still earns and still owns a place, not only in the history of the Disney company, but in the present of the Disney company and in Magic Kingdom and Tomorrowland. All right, so you sit in your seat, it rotates around the stages. It was a huge, huge hit at the 1964-1965 World's Fair. It was such a big hit during the World's Fair that even though 200 people could enter and exit the attraction every 4 minutes, it still often had over an hour-long wait. So, I mean, this attraction was and is a people eater, but it was so big in 1964-1965 that there was an hour wait on average. That is insane. So at the World's Fair, after the show, you would go upstairs in the pavilion, and up there would be the model of Progress City. Of course, Progress City was Walt Disney's Epcot model, and it was enormous. Now, if you've been on the People Mover, Tomorrowland Transit Authority People Mover in Magic Kingdom, you've seen just a slice, just a little tiny piece of his Progress Land model. And you might be saying to yourself, wow, it's a pretty big piece. It's not. It is tiny compared to the rest of that model that Disney used to have on display at the World's Fair. And of course, that same model went on to be on display in the second floor of the attraction in Disneyland as well. So yes, once the attraction had finished its run at the World's Fair, they took it apart, packed it all up, moved it to a new rotating theater in Tomorrowland, in Disneyland. Of course, that was Walt's plan, right? He built the attractions, he and his Imagineers designed the attractions at the World's Fair to eventually be moved over to Disneyland. This did two things. One, it got huge, huge awareness of Disneyland on the East Coast. It let the East Coast fans see what Walt Disney and his Imagineers were capable of before even coming to Disneyland. It provided their sponsors with these huge attractions for the World's Fair. And eventually, they needed just to pay the difference in shipping the attraction out to Disneyland. They didn't have to build new attractions for the park. They were already built. Of course, the one attraction that didn't make it from the World's Fair to Disneyland was the Ford Magic Skyway. And there was an episode way earlier, I can't remember the number, where I talked to Bob Gurr about the Magic Skyway, and he talked all about why it didn't make it over. I'll try to tag that one in the show notes, so if you go onto the website, you can kind of listen to that one next, so you can see why the Magic Skyway didn't make its way to Disneyland. And actually, it's a fascinating story behind the Magic Skyway itself. So yeah, I'll try to tag that one. Anyway, one thing I wanted to mention was some of the talent, some of the people who were behind Progress Land, who were behind the Walt Disney's Carousel of Progress. So earlier on a different podcast episode, I said that Rex Allen was the voice of the father in the Carousel of Progress, and that's true. He was the voice of the original father. So back in the 60s and back in Disneyland, he was the voice of the father. The newer voice of the father in the attraction is Gene Shepard. He is the one that was also the narrator in A Christmas Story. So I got that a little backwards in a previous episode. I wanted to make sure that I kind of went back and corrected it, righted the ship, if you will. So yeah, originally it was Rex Allen, now it's Gene Shepard. And who is the voice of Uncle Orville, Cousin Orville? You know him, the guy who says, "No privacy at all around this place." That is a terrible impression, but that is none other than Mel Blanc. So the voice of Bugs Bunny himself has a couple of lines in Walt Disney's Carousel of Progress. Now, the original song, of course, for Carousel of Progress is the Karen song that we have now, which is "There's a Great Big Beautiful Tomorrow Shining at the End of Every Day." I kind of want to put the song in here. I might put it in. Of course, if you were around my age or my wife Amy's age and you grew up with this attraction in the Magic Kingdom, that isn't the song that you grew up with. The song that you probably grew up with is "The Best Time of Your Life." So both songs were written by the Sherman Brothers. The original, of course, was written during Walt Disney's time, and that was the one that Walt Disney loved, and he had the Sherman Brothers write for the original Progress Land attraction. Now, when this attraction was shipped up and moved to Magic Kingdom, GE was still the sponsor, but they decided they didn't want guests to have to wait for a great big beautiful tomorrow. They wanted the guests who were on the Carousel of Progress to buy their appliances today. A little side note, the Sherman Brothers always felt that the original song, "There's a Great Big Beautiful Tomorrow," was still a better fit than "The Best Time of Your Life," which, by the way, I sometimes say is "Now is the Time." That's not the name of the song, but it confuses me and I think everyone, because the song goes, "Now is the time, now is the best time, now is the best time of your life." So there, it's confusing that you would think it would be called "Now is the Time," but it's called "The Best Time of Your Life." Not to be confused with the Righteous Brothers song, which I'm sure is disappointing ladies and dirty Dancing fans everywhere. All right, no, don't sing that song. Okay, so as you may notice, it's very difficult to summarize 50 years of an attraction into 15 minutes. So I'm not going to try to. I'm going to stop here, and I'm now going to give you some fun facts, some cool information about Walt Disney's Carousel of Progress. Did you know? Now, I said that Gene Shepard, the voice of the narrator in A Christmas Story, is now the father in Carousel of Progress. Did you know that Rex Allen, who was the original narrator and father of the attraction, now voices the grandfather in the fourth act of Carousel of Progress? So yeah, Rex Allen is the grandfather at the end in the 21st century scene. You know, when they're like, oh, you had to walk both ways up the hill through the snow, that whole thing, that's him. Did you know that in 1981, the finale was changed to New Year's Eve in the home of the 1980s? Then, of course, in 1994, it became Christmas in the House of 2000. Now it is just kind of a confusing, although it's still lovable, but confusing combination of the past, the present, and the future in that final scene. Now, another change that was made in 1994 was they took out a little bit of, well, let's call it what it is, misogyny. Honestly, it was in there in the attraction for the first 40 plus years, where the father was a little bit dismissive of the women, especially his wife. You can hear that in this. I want to put a clip in here where you can hear a little bit of that attitude that he used to have.
That's my wife, Sarah.
But with my new wash day marvel, it takes only 5 hours to do the wash. Imagine.
That's right, folks. Now mother has time for recreations like
canning and polishing the stove.
Okay, mother. You just iron the wrinkles out of my shirts.
Yes, dear.
So yeah, Disney very wisely and very smartly took that out and made some changes to the script, which endears it a little bit more to everyone in the family. Now, some other things you might not notice about the attraction when you're there, but now you'll start looking for them. Look for the GE logos. They are still all over the place on the appliances throughout the attraction. Even though General Electric has not been a sponsor for an awful long time, there are still plenty of General Electric appliances in the show. Also, look for some old-fashioned, old-school Disney tributes in the attraction. When the daughter is talking on the phone and using that funky exercise machine in the 1940s scene, look at the little table next to her. There's actually a Mickey Sorcerer hat on that table. Of course, the Disney animated movie Fantasia came out in 1940. Now, when you get to the last scene, the Christmas scene, on the bulletin board by the mom's computer where she's sitting, you'll see a little yellow sticky note that is kind of held up by a pushpin. On the note is written, "Marty called, once changes!" Exclamation point. That, of course, is a reference to the late Marty Sklar, who was the longtime head of Walt Disney Imagineering. Then nearby on a dry erase board, you'll see it written down that Grandma and Grandpa's flight is number 1401, and it gets in at 8:30. Of course, the original address of Imagineering in Glendale, California is 1401 Flower Street. And the last tribute I wanted to mention is in the 1940 scene, if you look out the window past the red, white, and blue banner, you'll see a sign that says Herb Ryman, Attorney at Law. Of course, Herb Ryman was the one that famously spent that weekend with Walt Disney and drew the first ever master drawing for Disneyland. And that is going to do it for this week's episode of the Ear to There podcast, Walt Disney World Word of the Week. Thank you so much for listening. I hope you enjoyed this episode. I hope there was something in there. I know it was a little scatterbrained and all across the board, but I hope there was something in there that you didn't know that you learned that you're going to go tell someone. That would be awesome. Like I said, it's hard to kind of fit 50, 60 years of an attraction into 15 minutes, and I didn't. We're going on 20 minutes, but I really tried hard. So I hope you enjoyed this episode. Thank you again so much for listening. I really appreciate it. Don't forget to head over to eartothertravel.com/iTunes to rate and review the podcast. And just remember, there will be a new episode of the Ear to There podcast each and every Monday, as well as a new episode of the Word of the Week, or someday It's a Food World will come back each and every Thursday. So until next time, thank you again so much for listening. Happy holidays. Bye-bye. Ear to There.